Hi guys, before I start the video, I'm gonna say that I usually do car review for every new set and mini. However, I do not want to do a VOD because it's way too long. So if you want to catch the streams, usually just follow on my Twitch and like on the spoiler dump, usually we don't do this kind of review. So join us, you know, it's a lot of fun. You can even trash talk or watch me trash talk your waifu. Have fun with the rest of the video. Alright, so the new expansion is here upon us. It's called Something Dragon Worm. Okay, I can't even remember. Roar of the Dragon Worm. Gave us a lot of power creep cards, actually. Like, if you're not familiar with the power creep, it basically means the cards are more powerful than previous sets and should shake the meta, unlike a certain boring expansion last set. Paradise. But, so yeah. We're gonna do like the typical day one deck. I have a lot of decks lined up for you guys, and this time we just stole it from either some pro players or like notable players. So yeah, that's not me. If anything goes wrong, you can blame them. However, I'll be shouting up them, so feel free to follow them or even take a like at their Twitter and whatnot. So the first one we have Pot Washer's Forestcraft. This is basically his spin on what I would believe is a combo aggro? I don't know even, like, to be honest, Whirlwind Assault is such a, like, weird card, but it's very powerful when you are able to, like, keep drawing multiple copies of it. So, the idea here is that you are running, like, decent card draw with the new kitten, of course, our beautiful Balmy Ringer is always there. Other than that, it does have very good aggro kind of, like, push. You are running, like, some of the new cards, like the Marchet Elf, that's like a on ping deal one. Lancer is also a Storm card if you guys are not familiar with that. The Spirit of the Spring also allows him to reach 4 plate easier, and he is also running the new Ambush guy, Owlman. So it's a more like an aggressive approach of the deck, which I'm not really inclined to like oppose it. It's actually very good strong, and like you're playing Ryan as well. Ryan is just good value, so overall this is like an idea. If you guys want to go for it, go ahead. Or if you want to go for a more controlled deck, there's also Dian's take on it, which is more an evil approach. 4-plate Roach, and it does run like very traditional card. You see like the Mage Goblin. However, I don't know if the Mage Goblin is as good as it was before, because this Mage Goblin is kind of like random for your information. Unless you banish like a 2-drop, it will always guarantee a 1-drop. In this case, if you do banish a 2-drop in this deck, it will guarantee you the cat. One of the most broken cards in this expansion right now, I think, for Forestcraft. The spin of this, let's play Bastion. I don't know about playing Bastion personally because I don't think Bastion is that good. However, you are playing 4 cards, you are trying to like achieve that Roach Tutor end of the turn, and Bastion like is infinite value in some sense, so maybe it's not wrong to play Bastion and you're trying to control the game. I don't know, this seems a bit copium, but it is a deck. If you guys want to copy it, go ahead. Dian is a very notable forest main, you know, take his word, not mine. Alright, up next we have Yoshiko's spin on the Bahamut Forest list with people spinning around. So, the idea is that Bahamut 50 play can be easily achieved with Forest Crop because you run Cryptic. Cryptic is basically a 4 play pawn card that technically is free if you bounce it. So, it's a 5 play card because usually the bounce are like 1 play point or 2 play point bounce. It's not really a bad idea, actually, honestly speaking. And like, it does also run the more evil control variant, and it also run Roach spell, which targets only the cat and a few 1-drop. I don't think it's really a bad idea, honestly speaking. You are able to like play multiple 4-play cards. I think the spell is just there for like alternative win con, but I think the main goal here is just to like drive up your Bahamut and be able to win from Bahamut from there on. Mitigating your deck's, reducing your opponent's deck to 5 and like winning from there. Alright, up next we have my own spin on it. I myself also made a Roach list. However, mine is more on the using a Shining Valkyrie. So mine is more very heavy, more aggressive as well. It's kind of like Pot Stick on like the aggro version, but mine is much more, I would say, honest and using a Shining. I just want to include Shining Valkyrie in the deck, alright? She's beautiful, but true to be told, I don't think she will make the top cut meta. But if you guys want to use a deck on Shining Valkyrie, and you have 3 of them, feel free to use this one. It utilizes Noctis Elf, which you can cycle more into your Assault Whirlwind. You have multiple targets for Assault Whirlwind. You are running one of the most strongest 1-drops in the Forestcraft right now, which is the Leafman and the Kitten as well. Alright, up next, we have Swordcraft. So, this is from Kaoru, which is a more mid-range sword list that we have been seeing. Some people call it aggro, but I still consider it called mid-range. where it's basically the same deck as last expansion. The only difference here is that we have the addition of Luminous Mage and Luminaria Knight herself, which is not really a bad addition. Also, Aurelia is very strong. So, what's the con of this new version? There's no cat. Camera is gone, so rarely it's harder to get. However, we do get the new Lancer. This Lancer is not funny at all. This Lancer also on 4 allows you to get rally 3. So it's kind of like a cat replacement in some sense. Even better than cat going first. However, you have to understand that without cat, going second is just much more weaker in this deck. So cards like Luminarian is quite welcome because Luminarian just tilts a 2 drop and make it 0. You can also tilt the Lancer, like I mentioned. Lancer is on play summon 1 more. So yeah, you can get 3 rally on turn 4, which is not that bad. However, you can make a more evil slow version, which is I present to you here. Legendary Sword Commander's version, where you are playing Kagemitsu and the boys, you are running more evolved stuff because you are able to like evolve easily with the Luminous Knight. I choose not to run Luminaria here because I don't really have space for the deck. However, if you insist on running her, you can cut cards like Royal Summons, I guess, but I think Royal Summons is quite tall for like having the engine to keep going. You need more cards to go on because this deck really like goes on for like to the turn 8 onwards. You, unlike the other version where you are kind of like mid-range and just playing cards for power level, you just, for this deck, you're actually just setting up. So that's actually the issue here. Legendary Sword Commander is not that bad. I think once you slam it down and like if the matchup allows it, you technically win the game. Other than that, it's actually just the same deck in my opinion. This is just having the evil version. Oh, you want to be full monkey? I got you. We are playing Aggro Sword. So memes aside, you can run Golden Warrior in this list because of the amount of abundance of one drop in here. However, I don't think that it's needed because you can play without it. Honestly speaking, the deck is still technically playing one of the more powerhouse cards like Erica, Musketeer, WoW. You still have those very, very strong cards. However, you're just running like Swift Speed Quick Blade. This card is very strong because like in like turn 5, you can play this along with Forged Weaponry that with Rally 10 gives you +4/+4 if you guys didn't know. So Quick Steel Blade is basically 12 damage on turn 5, which is insane, a lot of damage. Might be able to close the game. If it's like turn 6, you can even save like a buff from the Arsene Lupin and then buff it to the Quick Blade. So that's like with the Forged Weaponry, 14 damage. You know, you can do a lot of crazy stuff. This deck is very, very aggressive. You play a lot of one drop. It's consistent in the way that you can always play card, but hand size wise, don't look at me when you have no hand size. Alright, up next we have what is anticipated to be the best Runecraft deck, which is the Dirt Rune. So this deck is not actually mine again. I stole a lot of decks in this video, all the links are below. I stole it from Mr. Keo himself. This is his version on Dirt, where basically we are running the new Levy. Levy is just broken, honestly speaking, giving you Crimson Sorcery on Evo. There's also Juno. Juno is also another crazy card where there are a lot of times where some of the Dirt followers, you don't really need them right now. Like, you don't need Riley right now, you don't really need like Clay Sorcerer anymore. Broom, which is actually like a break at time. You don't have multiple Conscious Witch, fuse them away with Juno. Juno basically gives you a free Serdenum, which is very, very solid. Allows you to like just do that missing one Serdenum that you need, or even just trigger your draw effect with the Warden and Rumble. So, other than that, the deck is just very solid right now. I think this is probably the best Dirt you can get in rotation, and hopefully this pushes them to tier 2 at the release. I do hope that. Up next we have this is made from Mr. Auto Aim himself as well. This is just him having fun. So if you look at this deck only can run 2 followers, Minaria and the Sorcerer of 7 Force itself. So what's the idea here? Hear us out. You're gonna evolve the Mysteria Origin, reduce Imagine Realize on 6, place Imagine Realize on 6, and you get 7 forces and you evil him. How good is this? Don't find it. How fun is this? Probably really fun, because if you look at this list, when you evolve 7 sorcerer, you're probably gonna be able to like play all these cards. There's so many low cost spells that the moment you play Sorcerer 7 Force, you probably just win the game at that point. If you don't look at us, don't find me, find Mr. Auto Aim. This deck is not to be taken serious, but it is a fun deck if you want to play. However, if you want a more competitive rune deck besides Dirt, hey, your Golem spell is pretty still good. So the problem with the old Dirt version is that we lost a significant amount of like the good deck cards, mainly Hurricane. Hurricane is a very big loss. So the idea here is that we're going to play more follower based and like using Mysteria here. There is a spin where you still play the Dirt Engine and like be able to like work it out. Or you play more for followers, like playing more Sacred Wisdom and stuff. The ratio here is much more skewed towards more spells. Due to the reason that I want to utilize Mysteria here. However, in my honest opinion, I think you should cut Mysteria to 2, Insight back to 2, which is the more meta list, and then play Sacred back to 2 to 3, because the huge draw one is really, really insane, and like, you really just want to fuse for Isabelle, honestly speaking. The problem with doing that is that you'll be using less spells to utilize with your Mysteria. However, Mysteria Hyrule was pretty crazy. Like, you can get like a 0 play point Insight, 0 play point Secrets, a 1 play point Misser, but we'll probably cut Misser in the more optimalist, honestly speaking. You can even like get a 1 play point counter magic. Like basically you can do a lot of crazy shit. Like even 1 play point story just seems crazy. So like the Hyrule potential Mysteria is very, very high, but other than that, is the payoff worth it at times? Not really. I think that you should be running more Wisdom, but hey, if you want to experience the fun Mysteria, there you go. This is a list that you can try. Up next we have what I would presume is the OTK Dragon that I was very hyped about. I was very hyped when I saw Ignis Flame, like the effect is unchanged. So we were discussing how do we abuse this OTK. So Ignis Flame has a few problems before we talk about this deck. He doesn't have Rush, he needs Strike Follower, and he has an Evolve effect that kills Follower. So in the event that your opponent doesn't like play a tall Follower, anything that above 5 HP for Ignis Flame trade over to deal his 10 damage on Strike, we have a solution, chat. We have the solution. We have the magic. What if we have 12 play points and we can make Piercing Roar? Piercing Roar does indeed give you Rush. And the cherry at the top, you do deal like half of the damage of the attack of Ignis Flame. So, Ignis Flame deals 5. Piercing Roar deals another 5 because of 10 attack. And Ignis Flame himself deals 10. So that's 20 damage right here. And this deck runs a shit ton of RAM. I'm telling you so much. Metatron is like the new Rami on the town, you're probably gonna use her if you go second. Shindong is there if you really need it. Gina. Heck, I even run Frostbite Dragon, which is the weakest ramp out of them. So have fun. Terra Phoenix also tilters in flame. So all the decks here is just a tilter and ramp. So what you need to do here? Ramp and Hyrule. That's all you need to do. Alright, then up next we have the more reasonable approach of the Dragon deck, which is Phase Dragon. Basically you are running a lot of this good value card. Heron of Ador, Dragon Breeders are just really good one drop in combination with the new Twin Drake Guide. If you go into overflow, they just tilt and draw cards. To be honest, there are some debate where you should run more Angels of Boom so that you can have a potential of running more of the Fountain so you can buff Forte and the boys. I do prefer Lethal Dragon Scyther because I just want to go phase. There are other lists that also run cards like Angel's Grace so that you can avoid war and just go phase. Another interesting thing is that Metatron does work with Rowan. On Fanfare, you can deal 2 and heal 1, which is insane. So we're just gonna run Metatron, because Metatron is just a crazy card. Overall, this card can play Tempo early, Solov, and also have very high end core with the Forte and Gummers, and it's looking very strong in my opinion. And then up next, we have the. This is unchanged. Honestly speaking, this list has never changed. You're never gonna see this deck unnerfed. Unless they really do nerf it. And this deck is still gonna stay around. Loses nothing except for Tracing, so what do you replace? Well, Coral Souls is a very good card. Draws 2. Do I need to explain why is it good? Okay, so the only thing that I probably need to explain is Ambitious Goblin Mage, because the usage of this card is very, very unique, I would say. So here's what's gonna happen. If you do banish like a 2-drop, it's a guaranteed Luna Surge, which is really solid so that you can get it for your Necro 6, and also the fact that you can just draw one with Luna. Luna is a good card to tutor. Goblin also is really good where you can just pull back your Suzy if you really need it. And you can Hyrule into a Runai, or doesn't matter, you can still get your good 2-drops. Serenus, Gilalis, Conductor, those are really good 2-drop, and of course our beautiful Bell Ringer Angel. So overall, Goblin is a very interesting tech here. However, I'm not sure if this is the best list you can find. Maybe the best list is to play like, I don't know, just zero Goblin and just play good elves, good cards like Suzy and just Max of the Raider. The last word, Shadowless. This one's from Prey, Praetorian right here. This is just a typical last word. You just slap all the good last words and then play with Raider. This is Raider.exe. Nothing special, honestly speaking. Besides the fact that you lose Rebirth, which is a really big loss for the deck, you also lose Gatekeeper, which is also one of the reasons why I'm not confident in this deck. And before we go to the next shadow deck that doesn't exist, I'm not gonna make the 9 PP card. So look, I try to always make every card work, at least legendary wise, so that it looks cool, but I can't bring myself to do it. The card is just really too weak. I'm not gonna do it. Alright, up next we have Ravlet. This one is a courtesy of Kyo as well. As you can see, I'm too lazy to make my deck. So Mr. Kyo himself has employed the Rav version with the Vanya. Vanya is a very powerful card. Vanya on herself is 7 damage if you activated her Rav or Vengeance condition. Basically speaking, there's a lot of burst for just one card. And also the deck still works really well. You still have really good Rav card with the new support like Spiderweb. Imp is pretty good. You still have the good old Urias combo. You still have Omniface, which is pretty decent. Balls, Chain and Ogre is just a very good remover. Noble Demoness is still really strong. Wade is actually a very strong tempo creator, and so a draw too. Bloodsucker is still very solid with Vanya in combination. So overall speaking, you still have everything. And like Urias is still one of the strongest blood cards that you can ever see. I think this deck has a lot of potential, and I hope that people break or explore more of this version of the deck. And then up next we have the Unchained Hemless Blood. If you're looking to rush for ranks and take free wins, this is probably the deck to play. So instead of playing the Goblin Warrior, I think his name, we are playing the Faring or Goblin instead, because honestly speaking, the problem with that card is that every time you draw, like let's say a combination of Bad Usher and him, you can't play the Bad Usher for the maximum value of 0 hand. So at least the Faring Goblin like allows you to do that while not giving up a 1 drop tempo. The new card also includes the Sanguine Slash, which is very, very solid. If your top deck is still a 3 damage to the face guaranteed, because the damage is random, so you don't have to be worried about like targeting stuff. The deck still works. If you guys know what I'm talking about this deck, you should know. If you don't know, you can have a ton of guides, just type out in YouTube. You should know how to play this card. But it's one of the easiest deck I think that's highly competitive. And up next we have Mono in combination with Doomlord of the Abyss. So Doomlord of the Abyss is a very powerful card in my opinion. If you have Vengeance, you can just make it to the 6 cost, play it down, and it has the what we call the Zoe effect, which you can't die. So, and you can't die, right? And then you deal a lot of damage. You can just set it up with Mono Nexus and win the game. Mono also works with Vanya a lot, because Vanya summons a lot of followers and Mono just evolves them to like easy cost. So instead of like playing the normal conventions that you usually use, you're using Vanya instead, which is very, very like easy to do. Your Vanya activator here is, of course, the Scepter Shapeshifter. The engine we run here is basically to stay in paradise to tilter your Room Service and Itsurugi. Itsurugi is an okay card, allows you to draw one, dig deeper to your deck. And also, if you have like the Evolve effect, it's a good ping one where usually like the 19 damage kind of matters. We play one Scarlet Witch because why not? We do need that Vengeance Activator. And Dancing Mini Soul is not that bad. Like, if you can evolve it for tempo, let's say in combination with like Gilnalis, Metatron, or Behringer Ringer if you're trying to stall a turn, getting the free evolve for Soul Heart Devil is actually not that bad. Soul Devil also like gets auto evolved with Mono if you can evolve Mono herself. So I think it's a good inclusion. I don't think the deck is like that strong, but if you're looking to play a Mono deck, hey, have fun with it. Alright, up next we have Havencraft, which is really much the most shocking one, where Warhaven is actually not that bad. Like Warhaven with John is okay, but I think John is not the big dealer. The one that really break the deck to become one of the better ones in my opinion are like the overall support. Tina is just a 2 mana free evolve. Like, this card is crazy. Sublime Talisman is a 1 mana free Baron initially. Essentially, sorry. Metatron is just Metatron. Metatron is broken. Like you can see that most of the deck I run, if I don't know what to do or like, I'm trying to go for the late game, I just run Metatron. Metatron just solves a lot of problems. Metatron basically is the Ramiel of our current format, and I'm hoping that she doesn't make the format boring. Alright, up next we do have Amulet Haven. Amulet Haven actually have very strong gold card, which is the Prism and also Crusader Relling. The only problem is that they don't have good win con. They also even have a good silver, which is the Implements, which allows you to literally reduce one cost and last to draw one. I don't know why it's so good. Vardra Champion is getting reduced very easy. The only way I think our win con is probably God of Curses, so we had to accelerate God of Curses. We are playing the natural package with the Meowskis because they're still solid and good. Where's Must Fruit? Alright, I just realized a very big mistake. This list doesn't run Muskrut. Please run Muskrut. I'm sorry, this is a mistake. Imagine there's a random Muskrut here, okay? Like, you can take out Bishop, I guess, or Featherfoot, Windcaller. Let's take one of them and play your Muskrut for the guarantee Mousecraft search, please. Ah, this is so bad. Okay, up next we have Polycraft. Oh yeah, before we actually move to Polycraft, yes, same thing, I'm not making Imperial. Wherever the thing is, I'm not making the 0 agents attack. You can't make me do that. Okay, unless we have Puppet Potter, which is the most anticipated card. I think this is the one card that everyone anonymously agree that Orchids is just broken. Undeniably just break the game. And I agree, she literally broke the game. So the idea here is that you're going Metatron. If you go in second, Metatron evolve into Orchids. So we're playing a lot of like Puppet Generators that you see here, so that we can guarantee the 3 fuse into Orchids for the full value. However, there are also other game plans. If you don't draw Metatron, you can play the Lishana game plan. Lishana is not bad as usual, works into Orchids, and even then, like if you don't ramp, you can play like a tempo turn 5 into Orchids, turn 6 to get a huge tempo stream while going phase, while trading everything, while standing up for Lishana. The deck does look very, very solid. You also have the end game with Jetpack Gunner, which is a very solid end game. Ramiu is also very good for like just mocking. Overall speaking, I have very good vibes about this deck. I hope this deck actually finds success and finally becomes like an accurate tier 1. Alright, and last but not least, we have a Potter Dragon Bahamut deck. I think Bahamut is a very, very special like deck building unique thing that I want to like see what kind of deck utilizes it. So for me, Resonant does rings a bell. Like Resonant recover play point with Non, that's pretty good. And like, there's one card in particular that works very well with all these Renzo cards. Like Clementine is not bad, it just gives you like a free sort of Rezo count, and like the cards you run for Clementine Genesis is actually not that bad. Like Automated Maiden, that's a good Genesis count. Non, that's a 5 play point. Tetra targets the Bahamut, that's pretty good. Like Summon Divine Treasure is actually a very solid card. That's just 2 count for Genesis, and it's a very good control tool where you can either get a total or draw 2 heal 4 or anti damage 4. The 3 damage removal doesn't really matter. Overall, I think the deck works great actually. It might have a lot of potential. Alright, that's it for the video. I kind of speed run this because it's like 2 a.m. in the morning. I am very excited for the expansion. I hope that I can edit this before I go to sleep. And everything goes well. Like and subscribe, all those things. Thank you for everyone that has making their list and giving my list. I took some of them as well. All the links in below, follow them and stuff like that. Yeah, bye bye.